Hi, I'm John Mallows. Welcome to this live edition of Connect with Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this Monday morning. Tell you what, we have a very interesting program on the air, off the presses, with a photographer who went to Ethiopia, 436 Me TV, option 11. Today's program sponsored by Dr. Thomas Casagrande, 2020 Optometrics. Back here on the program, Connect with Me on a Monday morning. Glad you're here. Hope you had a great weekend and a lot to get to today. A very interesting first-time guest here on Connect with Me. Glad that she is here in the studio to share her story, a trip overseas that's kind of a once-in-a-lifetime thing, but we'll get to that in a moment. Quick programming note for tomorrow. Tomorrow we have the principal of St. Helens Catholic School closing its doors. Possibly, unless they can raise enough money to keep the doors open. The principal will be in here tomorrow morning to talk about that. He'll be a first-time guest as well. Then on Wednesday, we'll talk to Doug Vagum about some of the city issues going on, specifically marijuana. That issue coming before the city council on Thursday. That should be an interesting topic as to whether or not to open up these these stores that sell marijuana brownies, cookies, marijuana joints. So whether or not to sell it commercially is a big issue for the Fresno City Council, because you know what's going on in Coalinga. And certainly Selma has banned the commercial sale of marijuana. So Doug will have a big and wide-ranging opinion about that, I'm sure. For now, you're watching us live on Comcast Channel 375 as usual. If you don't have Comcast cable, you can watch us 43.6, 13.1 over-the-air broadcast, Monday through Friday, 10 to 11 o'clock in the morning. It's a call-in show, 436 Me TV, option 11. Now, you can catch the replay two more times on this day, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 13.6 YouTube, 8 o'clock tonight on 4.6 Biz TV. Later on, you can catch us on YouTube, of course. Well, how many of you know what the Archibald Project is? I'll bet many of you do not. It is an organization that claims to help orphans all around the world, and they do it through a camera lens. Yes, a camera lens. I want to roll the videotape, show you exactly what I'm talking about, my friends. Right here in the Central Valley, a local photographer was chosen to go overseas and document the less fortunate living in Ethiopia. In fact, she was only one of nine chosen from around the nation, and the only one from California. She recently returned and brought back these photos, the ones you're looking at right now, through her eyes, through her camera lens. Ethiopia is located alongside Somalia and South Sudan, along the northeastern tip of Africa, just south of Yemen, across the Gulf of Aden, in rugged, landlocked terrain with ancient Christian churches dating back to the 12th century. Ethiopia suffered, though, periodic droughts and famines that has led to long civil conflicts and obviously border wars and conflicts there as well. Archaeological finds date back more than 3 million years. With Ethiopian Orthodox, Muslim, Catholic all living in harmony, it may very well be the first nation to adopt Christianity as they migrated to Europe and beyond. But it's probably one of the poorest nations on earth, highly primitive, short on food, short on medicine, short on communications. They admire America, with many migrating to the U.S., many of them living in the Northwest, Washington, D.C., and the upper Midwest. These are the photos, but President Donald Trump is considering cutting foreign aid, which would have a major effect on that tiny country. The ban on Muslim immigration to the U.S. had been front page news in Ethiopia. Our guest was excited to go there, and she's excited to be here today. Live in our studio is Kimberly Wilson. She is the owner of Kimmy G Photography. She's been honored many, many times over for her excellent work in photography, but this trip could be her most exciting and obviously maybe the most excellent work that she's ever done. 436-ME-TV, option 11 is our telephone number here on Connect With Me on ME-TV Fresno on this Monday morning, sponsored by Dr. Thomas Casagrande. 2020 Optometrics, that's where I got these little specs right here. Back in just a moment with our first-time guest. At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today.
When you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on Energy Star qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Back here on the program, Connect With Me on ME-TV Fresno. So glad you're here on a Monday morning. And Kimberly Wilson is here from Kimmy G Photography and the trip to Ethiopia. You just got back when?
I got back March 6th. Yeah, back in
March
San Francisco.
March 6th. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
I'm glad you're here. First time guest.
Thank you.
Didn't make it this morning. The old train down the street
had you
held up there,
yes,
huh?
Yes.
Well, you know, that's when you needed to get the Jetsons, that car,
yeah,
and fly over
right
the train.
Over.
Hey, I'm glad you're here, though.
Thank you.
Talk a little bit about your trip. I know the Archibald Project chose you, right? Is that how it works?
Right.
Talk about that.
So the Archibald Project is a really cool nonprofit. It's a husband and wife team based out of Texas, and once a year they go on something called a media mission. And what they do is they put out a call on their social media outlet saying, hey, we're going to a place to talk about orphan care, and we love for other photographers to come along. Here's how to apply. So
yeah.
I applied, and they interviewed me and invited me to go along for the trip.
Wow. So
yeah.
When did they contact you, by the way?
Yeah. So I think the whole process started about mid-October 2016.
Oh, okay.
And then I got the confirmation I was going by mid-November. And yeah, we headed out February 22nd.
So you just received a phone call from who specifically? From the Archibald Project. There was somebody from the Archibald Project that called you, or how did that work?
No, they put out a call on their social media asking for photographers to apply.
Oh, so you didn't receive a call
on
your
phone? So I
didn't
specifically, no. So they asked people to apply. So I applied for the position, and then from my application, they called me.
Oh, I see. So they reviewed your application online.
Right.
And did someone call you after that?
Right. So we set up a Skype interview, and we did it face-to-face on the interview, and just kind of talked about, like, my heart for orphan care and how it blends with their organization, yeah. And they invited me to go the following week.
Did they, what kind of questions did they ask you on the Skype interview? I'm just curious.
Basically, I think that application process, like the application itself, answered a lot of the questions that she would have specifically. So
yeah.
The Skype interview was more about, do you think you could actually do this? How would it be leaving your family? Because I have a husband and 2-year-old at home.
And oh, you got a 2-year-old.
I do. So she said, would you be okay leaving him for 10 days? Is this something that you feel like you could do? So kind of feeling like personally where I stood on the project versus ethically where I stood on the project.
And so did they ask you questions about could you handle going to a country like Ethiopia?
They did.
That is obviously, you know, it's overwhelmed with nothing but poverty.
Right. Right. They did. They asked me if I had been on any trip similar to this in the past, or if I had been on any other mission type filled trips. And I told them I've been to Mexico several times, but nothing to that extent. You've never been overseas across
the Atlantic like that.
For my honeymoon, I went to Ireland, which is super nice and luxurious. Wow. So this is definitely different. This is definitely different.
And so did they tell you did they explain to you what kind of conditions you'd be living in? For how long were you there, by the way?
10 days.
Did they explain it, that you're going to be living where, like a tent?
They said, how much do you enjoy camping, they said. And I thoroughly enjoy camping. And so they said, okay, it's not going to be that bad, but prep yourself for camping like conditions. So we did. We took baths and a bucket bath, and we sometimes didn't have toilets to use. We had squatty potties, and it's just a totally different experience than what we have. Running water and clean water is very, very, very important, and we are lucky to have it.
Talk about the conditions there that you saw in terms of water. Not clean, right?
They have a public water system that is okay for them to use because they're used to it, but for us it would be really unhealthy. So we used bottled water, and at the compound that we were staying at, provided by Salamta Family Project, they actually have a splash water system there that allowed them to filter water for us to fill up our water bottles. So it was perfect filtered water.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. So you're there 10 days. We have a lot of videos to show.
Yeah.
We actually have 10 galleries to show. We showed one of them during the monologue segment. We'll also talk a little bit about the Archibald Project, which obviously you applied online with. Mm-hmm. How many others? Were there thousands that applied?
You know what? I asked Whitney and Nick, the founders, and they didn't give us a straight answer. I think they just wanted us to know that we were chosen for a specific purpose, and that they didn't want us... I don't know. They didn't tell us the exact number, so I was wondering about that myself.
You should have pressed them on
it a little bit. I know.
So is this once a year that they take that trip?
Not specifically to Ethiopia, but they do. They take a media mission once a year. They take a group of photographers once a year to go storytelling for orphan care.
It could be anywhere in the world.
They actually left us and went straight to Romania, and they still haven't come home to Texas yet because they're on another project right now. So they literally travel the world.
So they were in Ethiopia with you.
Right.
And so you met them in person.
Right.
You met them for the first time when you were in Ethiopia.
Right.
Really?
Yeah. So my mom, she says, are you sure you trust these people? But I did. I really, truly do trust them. And our whole team, we actually met for the very first time in New York before we got on our plane to Germany. And we went from Germany to Saudi Arabia and Saudi Arabia into Ethiopia. So. Yeah.
All right. All together probably took you about 24 hours, huh?
30, actually.
30 hours?
Yeah.
Yeah, more than a day.
Yeah. Yeah,
it takes a long time to get over there with all the connecting flights and all the different countries over there. So, all right, Kimberly Wilson is here. Kimmy G Photography. She went to Ethiopia on what is called the Archibald Project. They go around the world helping orphans, and they document what happens. We'll ask Kimmy about that project a little bit more as the program progresses here, and we'll show you all of those video galleries that... our producer here, Carrie, put together so eloquently. She did a great job. That looked great in the monologue piece because, these pictures are, they say a picture is worth 1,000 words.
They do.
So, but when you got there, to see everything in person, not through a camera lens, but with your real sight, your eyes, had to be an alarming experience for you.
What they did is really cool. For the first 3 days we were there, we rarely picked up our camera. Only for fun did we pick up our camera because they wanted us to immerse ourselves and really build connections with the people we were working with. So
they wanted you to soak it in.
Exactly.
Okay, before you start shooting.
Exactly.
Any pictures? Did you shoot video too or no?
I personally did not, but two other people on the trip did.
Yeah. Okay. All right, Kimberly Wilson is here. You're there, 436 MeTV, option 11, Dr. Thomas Casagrande, our sponsor on the program today.
At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today.
Not sure what you're watching? Want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated Biz Talk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV guide.
All right, back here on the program, 436 MeTV option 11 if you want to call in. We talked about the Archibald Project. It's an orphan care advocacy organization. They use the camera lens. They use the media to try to tell their story when they travel around the world regarding the less fortunate, those that are orphans and have not much food to eat, not very much water to drink in terms of clean water, and the squalid conditions that some of these people live in, not only in Ethiopia, but around the globe. I want to roll the videotape on the Archibald Project. It's got some sound. Here's what that organization is about.
My name is Nick, and together with my wife, Whitney, we started the Archibald Project. The Archibald Project tells stories. Specifically, we tell stories of orphan care. We travel the U.S. and the world looking for inspiring stories of orphan care. Whether it's adoption, foster care, running an orphanage, providing education, or any other creative way of helping orphans, we want to document these stories. The Archibald Project stories hold the power to educate and inspire people to get involved in orphan care. We believe this is true because we have seen it happen. We have seen our media make a difference in the lives of orphans, parents, and volunteers. The Archibald Project tells stories, and storytelling changes the world.
Right back here, that's the Archibald Project. It was started by Whitney and Nick, and you met them over there, and so you saw firsthand what they do in Ethiopia on the ground there. I want to roll video gallery number 2, and as you look at that monitor, Kimberly, go ahead and tell us, as you're seeing the pictures, tell us what we're looking at, if you could.
Yeah.
Okay, what is this right here?
I was really taken back by the amount of livestock just roaming the streets. They're not kept in pens. So this is a horse right outside our front door.
Okay.
Same thing with chickens.
Oh,
and
chickens
roosters
too, running around.
Running around. It was something that I don't know if I would ever get used to, just seeing them hang out right outside your
That's
front door.
That's another one, huh?
Those are some bulls, yeah.
Just hanging out, and they're not caged in.
They're not, and I was told that there's always some kind of shepherd nearby, that they aren't just roaming, but yeah, it's just, like, think about taking your kids for a walk and walking by a herd of cattle. It's just, that's the lifestyle.
And these animals don't seem to bother
yeah.
anybody. What's that right there?
That's just a vine growing through some rocks. I thought it was a beautiful image.
Okay.
Kind of showed the light through the darkness idea.
Uh-huh. And
this was some type of fruit. It's all over the place, every street we cross, and I was excited to see some succulents. Their climate is actually a lot like California. A lot of the same plants are grown there. I found that really comforting because I love gardening, so seeing the foliage was really cool.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing, these are some donkeys at a soccer field, and they were loaded up because it's like kind of going back in time in Ethiopia. You see people using donkeys and livestock to do everyday work like we would use cars.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. Okay. And we'll see some other photos too during the course of the program here. Let me ask you about the conditions there.
Right.
Go ahead.
Where we stayed specifically at the Tsalmta Family Project, I personally thought it was way better than I
thought. Where did you stay?
We stayed in Addis Ababa, right outside in a suburb. And it was
at a hotel, or
it was at Tsalmta Family Project's community center that we stayed at. So it was basically
so draw
it was
a picture for me. So you
story building.
Okay, three story building.
It was a three story building. The bottom is used as a community center for the families of Tsalmta Family Project to come hang out during the day.
So you slept in a bed.
The middle is offices, and the top story is bunks for people that are coming to help. So we had a bunk bed style.
Mm-hmm. Right, so that's where you stayed.
Mm-hmm.
So how far away was that from where you actually were working and taking pictures?
Oh, just a few minutes walk. We were walking to the family's houses all throughout the area right there in that suburb.
What's the biggest need for Ethiopia right now, and how much did you see that distressed you, and what did you see?
I don't think I could answer truthfully what the biggest need is for Ethiopia right now, but
well,
I could answer for Tsalmta Family Project. So they're a project that's helping orphans in particular, and their biggest need is financial funding because they are run from the United States, but they go once or twice a year to Addis to help in the orphan crisis.
But you saw orphans there.
Right.
What's their biggest need? Is it the shortage of medicine? Is it the shortage of food?
No, it's honestly like monetary donations is what they need because Tsalmta.
No, I'm not talking about the organization. I'm talking about the people of Ethiopia.
The people of Ethiopia, it's an extremely impoverished area. Like it's poverty like you couldn't imagine. But in Addis, it's the capital of Ethiopia. So we also saw some hints of what luxury looks like to them. It's the only country that's never been colonized, and you see roots of that throughout the whole country.
So you saw shortages of food, obviously, for these people.
I personally didn't come in contact with that. We had wonderful meals given to us by family members every single night. So
not talking about you, just the people of Ethiopia, though.
Right.
Did they have a shortage of food, shortage of medicine from the orphans that you saw?
I wouldn't be able to truthfully answer that. I don't feel comfortable answering that because I didn't hang out in extremely impoverished areas to answer those correctly. I was in a very middle class area.
So you were not in an area that was impoverished that much.
It's still extreme poverty compared to what we are used to. Their middle class versus our middle class is extreme poverty.
Yeah.
But it's not like you drive from where we're staying in the suburbs into the city, and there are people literally living in slums. So
yeah,
it's hard.
Okay, let's roll video gallery number 3 and take a look at some of those photos that Kimberly shot there and what she came in contact with. And we'll just go right down the list here. Okay, what are we looking at here? Where is this?
This is right in the community center foyer. We were playing soccer with some of the kiddos. It's kind of an international language. Dancing and soccer and sports is, you don't have to all speak the same language, but just have fun together. This is the kids taking us on a walk of their neighborhood.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, this is the kids playing soccer in a nearby field. Those 10 buildings behind are actually used for farming, and so like think greenhouses or chicken coops. This is at the Tsalmta Family Project where the kids come and hang out. There's this big group today because they actually were having an award ceremony that day for doing well academically. And this is a group of children that was putting on a little play for us, showing the creation of Tsalmta Family Project, which is really sweet.
Mm-hmm. And these look like typical kids.
And these are brothers. Yes, these are
how old?
Brothers. In their teens, they're like 15, 16 years old, with their looking over their mom's shoulder laughing. This is a little guy super proud to be on their postcard. So he was showing it off. Yeah.
Very nice. Looks like you took some in color, some in black and white, huh?
Yeah. I like to mix it up depending on what I'm feeling for that specific image. These are some girls just enjoying each other's company, hanging out at the soccer field while we were all having a good time. This is the same boy with his little photo. Mm-hmm. He was so proud.
Right, right. It's just some of the glimpses of some of the faces of the children of Ethiopia that, you know, looking at some of those photos, you would walk away thinking, gosh, you know, these could be typical teenagers, typical kids mm-hmm. anywhere in the world. Did they right. look happy to you, or did they look distressed? Right. How did they look to you emotionally and mentally?
I'm glad you actually said that, because it was my goal to show orphans in a way that was relatable. I didn't want... No. We have this idea of kids living in the trenches with flies around their heads, starving to death, and that's not always the case for what an orphan looks like. In Fresno alone, we have over 2,000 kids waiting for homes. So the typical everyday kids could still be orphans. These kids are put into a family, what Salamta does, and so these kids weren't sad when we left, because they have a family. They have a wonderful family.
Do they go to school?
They do. And
they have friends.
And they have friends.
And they play soccer.
Yes, yes.
And what else do they do?
They really encourage higher education, because Salamta family believes that they are raising up the next leaders of Ethiopia, and that's their goal, is to really... education is something people can't take away from you.
Before I go to break, I have to ask you, did you see any teenager this? And I bet I know what the answer to this. Did you see any kid there with a cell phone?
Everyone had a cell phone.
Everyone?
Every person had a cell phone.
The kids?
Everybody had a cell phone.
The kids had a cell phone?
It didn't matter if you were living in a hut, or if you were living in the suburbs, or if you were living in a high rise in the city, everyone had a cell phone. Because they don't have to pay for plans, they pay for minutes. So at every little community market, they could buy as many minutes as they want. They had iPhones, actually iPhones.
That's a stunning answer, because you'd think in an impoverished area like that, with a shortage of food, shortage of medicine, shortage of this, shortage of that, people starving all over the place. We know that it's not, I've never been there, but it's not a country like the United States. So when you have all these shortages of the necessities of life, they have cell phones.
Right, they do. They have cell phones.
Did that stun you?
It kind of just reminded me that we are in 2017. Like, they are up with the times. They wanted to know my Facebook account and my Instagram account, and they wanted to follow me and be able to comment and talk to me halfway around the world, which I thought was just so cool, how social media has truly affected the way we communicate around the world.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
That's pretty stunning.
Yeah.
Shocked at that answer. They probably have a better iPhone than I do.
They probably have the iPhone 7. No. They probably have the same one, but they know how to work it very well.
So what's the plan over there? Is it AT&T, Verizon? Do you have any idea?
No.
Who's the carrier?
It's just, there's no such thing as a carrier. There's minutes that they somehow use. I don't know exactly
minutes.
How it works.
Minutes.
Yeah.
All
so
right.
they have
it's
these little lotto tickets that they scratch off.
Oh my goodness. Kimberly Wilson is here, Kimmy G Photography, and we've shown you three of the galleries. We've got a lot more to get to. Half an hour left here on the program, 436-ME-TV, option 11 if you want to call in. We do have an open phone line on this Monday morning. Dr. Thomas Casagrande, our sponsor today.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Samsung big screen we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Time for that upgrade to an HD, 3D, web-enabled Samsung TV. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise today.
At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today. We'll be right back.
Revan is now on KVHF channel 4.4.
All right, back here with Kimberly Wilson. She's from Kimmy G Photography. And before we get to gallery number four, what do you specialize in?
I specialize in wedding and portrait photography. So I do about 10 to 15 weddings a year, and then the rest is all filled in with family and newborn photos. I love it.
How did you get involved with this, this whole photography thing?
Oh, my mom put a 35 millimeter film camera in my hand when I was about 9 years old, and I always took pictures. And then in college, I went to Fresno State for art, and I thought I was going to do drawing and painting. And I took my first photography class and realized I could actually make a career out of this. So I have my degree in photography from Fresno State.
Okay. Here's an email question from one of our viewers. Did you see any Somali refugees or political asylum seekers?
I did not.
You did not? No. Okay. So let's get to gallery number four, the video gallery. We'll talk over it, and you can tell us, look up on the screen there, Kimberly, and you can inform us as to what we're looking at. What is this right here? Interesting photo.
This is from the second story balcony, looking down there, preparing a party for all of us. And this is all, they're prepping, putting the meals out for us all to eat. This is a traditional Ethiopian coffee ceremony. Every night when we were eating dinner in the family's homes, they would end dinner with a traditional coffee ceremony. They would have these little lanterns, coals that they would light, and would do it right there in the living room. And they have it on grass. As you can see under there, the grass is considered good fortune. This is what a traditional kitchen looks like. It's almost in a garage outside of the home. It's not inside of the home.
Looks like a stovetop there.
It is. And there's a small refrigerator. And yeah, they definitely have what they need to make delicious meals.
What are the dishes like? What did you eat?
Injera. There was a lot of injera. So what it is, it's like a sourdough bread, but it's moist and really sour, and it's almost a sponge-like consistency. And you lay it out, and then they put the different options for food on there.
What's that right there?
They actually made us French fries, just to be kind.
Oh, yes. Really?
Yeah, just to be kind. They made us some French fries because they knew we'd love them.
Go ahead before I interrupted.
And that's the coffee ceremony again.
Oh, okay.
And you would use the injera with your right hand to pick up the food and eat it with your hand. So there's no utensils. Injera is the way to pick up the food, and you spin it around and you just eat the whole thing.
That's what you ate mostly?
Yeah, for pretty much lunch and dinner every day.
What about protein? What would you have for protein?
Lentils. There's a lot of lentils. They have over 220 days of fasting a year, which considers no meat, no dairy, no eggs. So
is that what you did?
So there is not even accessible really to us. So we had to live like that as well. So we were there during fasting time, so we ate as in fasting time.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Okay. How about video gallery number five here? We can roll the videotape and see what's going on in some of these photos here. How many photos altogether did you take on the 10-day trip? Hang on, caller. Go ahead.
I took about 1,000, over 1,000 photos.
And you sent us about 95 of
those. I did. This is Marissa on the screen, and she is the director of Salamta Family Project. She lives in Florida, and she goes to Ethiopia multiple times a year to run this program overseas. It's pretty amazing.
Okay. And we'll come up to the next photo here, I'm sure, as we play out this videotape here. And
yeah,
that's more the
Marissa,
same.
Yeah, Marissa talking to Johannes. Johannes just graduated from school doing this. He's doing film and lighting design, and he's actually working on the popular soap opera in Ethiopia.
How many of them want to come to the United States?
Everybody.
You're kidding.
So our driver told us you will not find one person in the whole continent of Africa that doesn't want to be an American.
That's a great photo.
Thank you. They are one big family, that's for sure. It was a wonderful time. I hope to go back over and over again. I loved it.
So you made some lifetime friends there?
Absolutely.
You got all their cell phone numbers, do you?
No, I don't have their cell phone numbers, but we do follow each other on social media, which is fun.
Okay, caller, you're on the air as we continue to look at some of these wonderful photos. What's your question for Kimberly?
Good morning, Kimberly. A couple questions. This is a loaded one. Did you take photos of the kids worshiping at a church? That's my first question, and I'd love to see it if you did. And second question, is it a Christian? Would you say most of them are Christian believers? That's maybe part one of part okay. A or B.
Yeah.
And then can American people adopt these children? That's my last question. So you got kind of three of them.
No, I got it. I got it. Yeah, I got it.
Okay, thank you. Thanks,
everyone. Yeah, yeah. So I did take photos at church on Sunday of worshiping, but it wasn't with the kids. It was just at an English service that we were able to attend the Sunday we were there. And it was probably one of the most powerful moments of the whole trip because it showed me that no matter where you are in the world, people worship God exactly the same, which I thought was really encouraging.
So most of them that you saw there were Christian?
At the church specifically?
Yes.
At the church we went to was a Christian service, yes. But the kids...
But overall?
Overall, in Salamta, majority of the kids are of Christian faith. They have Orthodox Christian and Protestant Christian. There is a large Muslim base there. Like, it would ring over the intercoms of the whole town first thing in the morning, a call to prayer. But I wasn't involved with that, per se. They all had some kind of Christian ties.
All right. And the third question, he had three.
Yes. What was the third question? I did forget.
I think the third question is about adoption. Can someone adopt?
Oh, right. So these kids that I photographed with Salamta Family Project, they aren't for adoption specifically. They are, what they do is they take a marginalized woman, they put them in a home with 8 to 10 kids and an auntie, and they are a forever family. So these kids are raised in a forever family. They all come from different backgrounds. They all are orphans at one point, but they all come together as a forever family.
Yeah, okay, roll the videotape on gallery number 6, the photo gallery number 6. We'll take a look at some more photos from Ethiopia, the trip of a lifetime here. What is that?
That is Whitney. That is what scaffolding looks like in Ethiopia. All those wiggly little branches. We're standing inside of a building that was being built, and that was scaffolding. That was Whitney, the head of Archibald Project. This
right.
is
and her husband, Nick.
Yes, and this is Grace. videoing on the...
That was a car?
That was. It was a little taxi, actually.
Okay, so that's how small the cars are there.
Yeah,
they're all like that, huh?
The taxis. I didn't see a ton of cars. We were either in vans or those little taxis. The kiddos...
Look at that little guy there.
Yes, the kiddos loved using our cameras and getting to be behind the lens rather in front of it. And this little guy was so good at it. This is Nick. He's co-founder of the Archibald Project, doing his video on the streets. Yeah.
Okay. Did you use film or was it all digital?
I personally did digital.
Okay.
Yeah. This is Johannes. He just graduated from technical school in film and lighting design. He is a really incredible guy. He's about 18, I believe, 19.
All right.
And this is Nick and Whitney working on a film.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You see a little bit of that scaffolding behind them. We were in a building that was being built. This is Nick videoing one of the girls part of Salamta. She's trying to come to America to study nursing. Her mom died of tuberculosis, and it's her dream to become a nurse to save people with tuberculosis. This is a little girl just playing with our cameras.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. And so what you saw these children, they range in all sorts of ages, most of them teenagers, some a little younger,
right,
maybe some a little bit older. Did they remind you of American teenagers, American kids, or were they different in some way because of where they live?
Personally, I really, really found so much in common with them. They have dreams and goals and aspirations, and they came from really, really dark, hard places, and it just shows how resilient kids are. A majority of them want to graduate college. In Ethiopia, you can't choose your major. The government chooses it for you. So It's their goal to either follow the path that the government gives them or to come to America to finish higher education, to go back. They don't want to come here to stay. They want to come here to learn, to take it back to their country and make their country better and stronger.
So they want to come here as like foreign exchange students.
Absolutely.
And then go back to Ethiopia.
Absolutely. There's a big handful of the kiddos.
Why do they want to go back to a country that's so impoverished?
Because their roots, it's a beautiful country, and they have so much to offer the world. They just don't have the means and education and medical assistance to get there.
Are the people there, did you find the people, especially the kids? We saw some of the faces. They mm-hmm. look happy, but pictures can be deceiving as well.
Right.
Did you get the sense that overall, the people that you came in contact with, the people that live in Ethiopia, whether it be adults or children, did you get a sense that they were overall happy with themselves, happy and content with their conditions?
When we were driving around the town, there's so many people that would come up to our cars, sticking their hands in, asking for money, asking for food. So no, in that aspect, no. The kids of Salamta Family Project, yes, I feel like they were happy.
The other general population seems like they're in need.
They are.
Shortage of food, shortage of medicine, clean water is a big problem.
Just
there.
Access to all of those things. Yeah. Yeah, money talks. As money talks in America, money talks there. And when you don't have any money, it's very hard.
Did it make you appreciate even more where you came from and what you have and what
right.
your living conditions are here in this country?
Yeah, Fourth of July is my favorite holiday. It always has been. And I came
right.
back 20 times more patriotic than I ever thought I would. Yeah.
Because
we have so much that we take for granted, and we have so much that we don't even need, and we think we do.
Did you see pollution there?
Not really, actually.
No,
Mm-mm.
you didn't.
Mm-mm.
Come to think of it, huh?
Yeah,
no
come
pollution.
To think of it. It was in a valley. We were surrounded by mountains, and it was over 7,000 feet. It was really high altitude.
All right, before we go to break, let's roll videotape number 7. Number 7, video gallery number 7. We're almost through all of these, and so go roll it and talk over what we're seeing here, Kimberly.
This is a little grassy lull area between two different communities. It was in the suburbs outside of Addis.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. This is looking towards that yellow building is the other side of Salamta Family Project.
Yeah.
And the little speckles out there is a whole herd of goats and sheep.
And the Family Project, again, is separated from
the Archibald Project.
The Archibald Project,
right.
right?
So the Archibald Project goes into different nonprofits and photographs on their behalf.
Okay.
Right.
All right.
So
and
this is looking down the road from where the community center we were staying at. So see, uh-huh. the road is like mud-filled and not paved. This is just another landscape of people. There's so many people walking. That's one thing, because transportation is very expensive. So
yeah.
everywhere you look, there's people walking. And
you see anybody riding a donkey or a horse?
Not riding them, but using them to carry their stuff.
Okay.
Yeah, so
okay.
leading them. There's a little soccer field. Trash all over the roads.
Really?
Oh, it's very, very, very dirty because they have so many other things to care and worry about. But it was funny. When I first got there, the trash and everything on the roads caught my attention. And I thought, oh my gosh, why do people live this way? But by the end of the trip, it truly became one of the most beautiful countries to me.
Did you find anyone there who was anti-American?
No. I didn't find anyone that was anti-American. Many of them questioned our president and what he was doing. But
I was just going to ask you
them,
that, but since you brought it up.
None of them were anti-America.
Give me some Trump stories.
It was just interesting even just flying through the airports. It was pretty much on every newsstand, every TV, everywhere you looked.
Trump's face was everywhere.
Germany, yeah.
The papers. But in Ethiopia, too.
In Ethiopia, they're not very, they don't like controversy and they don't bring up things, but we asked them and they said that he has potential of not being good for their country, and they're worried about
that. Because there are a lot of Muslims that live in Ethiopia, too, and because of the Muslim ban, it got a lot of attention there in Ethiopia, from what I was reading, and it was front page news, but even in Ethiopia, they're talking about Donald Trump.
Yeah.
Do people ask you about Donald Trump?
Nobody asked us about Donald Trump, but they are definitely...
conscious of it?
Conscious and paying attention. Like, America is America for a reason, and we have the attention of the world, and what we do matters.
Yeah, because if we cut Ethiopia off in terms of foreign aid, they're, you know, we've dealt with Ethiopia for many decades, and giving them foreign aid, if you know, in this next budget that comes out, if we cut that, the president decides to and Congress decides to, Ethiopia is going to be hurting even more than they are now.
Right.
I'm sure that was maybe top of conversation. Maybe you didn't hear it, but certainly that's what's going on.
Yeah.
They're worried about that.
They are worried. They're just, like I said, we're just in a place of power, and they want to make sure we're using our power wisely.
Yeah, they consider us an ally, and they
absolutely
like us.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Hey, got to go to a quick break here. Got three more videos to show, and we also have some sad news to pass along at the end of the program. 436-ME-TV, option 11, if you want to call in. Dr. Thomas Casagrande is our sponsor today. Back in a moment.
The Justice Network is here. If you haven't tuned in, you're missing a great lineup of gripping stories of real crime, plus an unprecedented effort by viewers like you to play an active role in making your community safer. You can help support law enforcement by providing information that may lead to the apprehension of dangerous criminals or find a missing child. Great shows and your chance to fight crime, only on the Justice Network.
At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Frigidaire Gallery appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start, but you really should touch the merchandise before you buy.
Time for that upgrade to an Energy Star qualified French door Frigidaire Gallery refrigerator.
Quality appliances for the way you live. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise.
Back here on the program, 436 MeTV option 11. A little time left. Let's roll the videotape on video gallery number 8. We got two more after this one to show. And Kimberly, looks like an office space here.
Yes, this is the second story of Salam to Family Project. This is Salam working with one of the directors going over college stuff. This is one of the families of Salam to Family Project. See, there's the mom there. The boy that is next to her in red is her actual biological son, and the rest of the kiddos she's taken into her home. This is, again, the coffee ceremony that she graced us with that evening.
Okay.
And we're all just laughing and sitting around watching the little boys put on shows for us. As much as there was a language barrier, there was a really fun way to communicate, and that was through music. They enjoyed Justin Timberlake and Beyonce and just fun American music, and they would put on little shows for us.
So they like Beyonce. Mm-hmm. What other American celebrities do they like?
They love Justin Bieber. I heard Justin Bieber so many times while I was there. I couldn't believe it. You know you're famous when you're famous all the way around the world like that.
So you heard Beyonce, you heard Justin Bieber. Yeah. Who else did you hear? Anything?
A lot of Justin Timberlake. His new song, Can't Stop the Feeling, was on all the time.
Right.
Yeah, it was fun seeing the little American influences there. This is the whole family of Salam to Family Project. They came together the second night, our first day we were there, and it was really cool to see everyone together as a family.
What is their goal?
Salam to? Their goal is to take marginalized women, women that have been abused or abandoned, and teach them how to be a moms. And through that, they take 8 to 10 orphan children and put them into a forever family. And they don't age out of these families. They are together forever as a family.
And the Archibald Project comes in, Nick and Whitney, and they do what?
And we come and photograph the sustainable way of orphan care. So we came in and photographed what the Slumta Project is doing and what how we could replicate it around the world.
Okay, go to videotape number 9, the video gallery here, because we want to get to all of these videos so you can see them. 436-ME-TV, option 11, if you want to call in. Go ahead.
This is the head mom. She's pretty much the mom to all the moms. There's 11 moms in Slumta family, and she was wrapping my birthday present. I turned 30 while I was there, and she gave me some soap.
You look like
while
you're
she
20.
Made. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. This is Salam standing in one of the buildings that was being built. I just thought it was a beautiful image of her and her sister. So beautiful.
Yeah, beautiful photos, too.
Thank you. Thank you.
It'll change here in a moment.
Yeah.
We'll go to the next photo, but it's...
This was a family. We're in their living room, and she was going through the lentils for dinner. The lentils come in that blue bag off to the side, and you have to swipe through them to get all the rocks and sticks and everything out of them. See the mom there? She's pulling everything out. So they don't have processed food like we have. They cook everything from scratch, and they make it the best they can, and it was wonderful that they hosted all of us. This is, he's wearing a Slumta family shirt. I just thought it was a cool depiction of what
they
do.
Hey, we have an email question here from one of the viewers. It says, Ethiopians, Ethiopia, is it an ag-based economy or no? Like the Central Valley is ag-based.
Right. I don't believe so. They need more people going in and teaching them sustainable ag practices. They do things like, it's like a time machine. Like you go back in time and you see the way that they're tending to their fields, and they don't have modern machines and modern things to make them sustainable. So,
all right. We got one, I think two more or one more video. We got one more, number 10, right? All right, that was number 9 that you saw here. Let's go to video gallery number 10 as we take a look at some black and white photos here for the first time. Second time, actually. Go ahead.
This is one of the moms that made us her coffee ceremony, and she was just hanging out. This is like driving down Herndon in the middle of the road just being cattle and hanging out.
Yeah.
So I thought that was just such a stark contrast to what we have here in America. This is looking over the top balcony of the Slumta Family Project, the beautiful hills in the background, and they're working, putting in some piping. This is my team walking to family dinner. It was such a beautiful place. I really enjoyed our time there.
All right, a call coming in here. Good morning, caller. Go ahead. You're on the air with Kimberly Wilson, who went to Ethiopia and is showing us some of her photos. Go ahead. Caller,
yes,
go ahead.
I'd like to direct a question to her, that how can she keep her emotions, you know, from, like me, when I see, you know, people having a hard time, it's an emotional thing. I sometimes cry about it and why not. For her and their group, I mean, how can you keep their emotion then, even though they're trying to help and teach and whatnot?
Okay.
Thank
you very much. So how do you keep your emotions about you?
Right. I prayed a lot, and I did. I cried.
Did you cry?
I did. I cried probably every day, but I didn't cry
because
out of sadness. I just cried. I cried out of thankfulness and gratefulness that this is where my life is here in Fresno, California, and how I've just been given such favor and grace to even be where we are.
But there are a lot of people that believe, and you may believe this too, I don't know what you believe, but a lot of people believe that Ethiopia is the cradle of civilization. And you were right in the middle of it. Like, that's where it all began.
Right, right. I think there is just something so profound about going to a place that had never been colonized and had just those really traditional roots. It was really inspiring.
All right. A lot of theologians obviously think that's where it all began. 436 MeTV option 11. We got to take a quick break here and come back with our final segment in just a moment.
Not sure what you're watching? Want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated Biz Talk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV guide.
Back here on the program, we'll get back to you in just a moment, Kimberly, but I want to pass along some very sad news here in the Central Valley and here in the city of Fresno. John Wallace, 71 years old, passed away today from complications of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. COPD is what it's called. And of course, John Wallace, well known here in the Central Valley for decades. He worked at Channel 30. He worked at Channel 47. He worked at Kino TV. He also worked in the mayor's office for Alan Autry many years ago when Alan was the mayor of the city of Fresno. But John Wallace, so beloved and so worked so long here in the Central Valley to try to help others. He was a newsman first. He loved television broadcasting, but he was also the spokesperson, the spokesman for the local MeTV here in the city of Fresno, MeTV Fresno. So our condolences, our thoughts and prayers with the family and friends of one John Wallace, a long-time news anchor here in the city of Fresno, well-respected. John was a friend of mine. I considered him a friend. I knew him for many years. I went through some hard times myself about 15, 16 years ago and, talked to John about it. And he had an open ear and was very willing to help in any way that he possibly could. But in recent years, he was suffering from health problems. And today, sadly, our friend John Wallace succumbing to those health issues, COPD, 71 years old, and he worked with so many people at Channel 30. You could name them all, but we'd be here for a couple of hours. So many people at Channel 47, we could name them all, but we'd be here until 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And he did so much for the people of the Central Valley to try to help them, the less fortunate. And John Wallace also worked at Kino, and interesting, to see what kind of reaction there is from the people who watched John Wallace, the people out there that watched him day in and day out and listened to him on Kino Radio and then eventually worked in the mayor's office. Interested to see the reaction from the one-time mayor, Alan Autry, as well. Goes by Carlos Brown is his real name. Did you guys know that? Anyway, our thoughts and prayers once again go out to the family of John Wallace, who sadly passed away today at the age of 71, a well-respected, long-time anchorman broadcaster here in the Central Valley. So, Kimberly, I hate to spring that on you at the last moment, but things happen. And so, some final thoughts about your trip to Ethiopia. We have 1 minute left.
I just want to encourage anyone that has ever thought of doing something like this or giving to an organization to help with orphan care to do it, because there is so much to be said and done for people that step out of their comfort zones and really love on the fatherless.
Yeah, okay. Sadly, we're out of time. And it was good of you to come in, though,
Thank you. Sharing
those photos and your experiences over there in Ethiopia.
Thank you
I really
for
appreciate
having
it.
Me.
And
Thank
I mean,
you.
You've won a lot of accolades, a lot of awards for your photography, and I can see why.
Thank you very much.
Outstanding work, and thanks for making it here today. Again, our thoughts and prayers go out to the family, friends of John Wallace, who passed away today at the age of 71. See you back here tomorrow with the principal of St. Helens. Have a good day.
At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today.
If you have a need to promote your business or event, please consider MeTV Fresno for your next campaign. MeTV reaches over 100,000 of your potential customers in the Fresno area every single week. Plus, you can rest assured that your commercial is running in the greatest family-friendly programs of all time. MeTV Fresno delivers a strong, loyal audience ready to buy, and your campaign will cost a fraction of what you're paying for your advertising now. Call me today to find out how affordable MeTV is